All right, so you've had the first lecture, which kind of basically sets up some of the reasons why engineers should be concerned with ethics. This lecture is going to go in depth into several different specific ethical frameworks with the concept that you don't have to be recreating the wheel when you are trying to puzzle out ethical dilemmas and come up with, which, is ultimately the point of the course, your own ethical kind of standpoint, or at least a place to start from when you may encounter an ethical dilemma out there in the real world. So we'll go into that momentarily. That's what we'll be talking about in this lecture. This course is about learning to consider the ethics of particular situations, of course. And so one of the things that we really want you to be able to do would be to apply the things you're learning in the course, concepts that you're coming into contact with, to your careers, the world of work, whatever it might be. Now, some of what we talk about in here, maybe there's a tendency to focus on these very profound, large-scale issues. Things like the development of the atomic bomb and the hydrogen bomb, historically. And the fights that happened, kind of the ethical wrangling between the physicists who created those projects. We'll talk more about that next week when we talk about the problems of the unknown that arise, when engineers, physicists, whatnot embark down a path. And you're also going to, on Wednesday, have already seen clips that deal with these issues, and then we'll talk about them in class next Monday. So those are big ideas. We also have some very, sometimes mundane, and this is probably much more likely, the types of issues that you would have to deal with, hopefully, in the world of work. Things like cheating on time cards, or borrowing, quote-unquote, office supplies, fudging costs and schedules, to make a company look better, that it's delivered something faster and under budget. I had a student once who came back, or at least I ran into her several years after she had taken the course, and she said that some of the ideas in the course, she really hadn't used, or she had to kind of draw on until she was working. And it was a kind of a mundane issue, but it was an important issue nonetheless. She was being asked to bill for hours that she had spent basically stuck in traffic up in the Bay Area. And, that was when she, pulled out her ethical framework that she had created, cobbled together. And, that was a moment when that actually helped her. Again, a mundane issue, but something that you might run into. We'll also talk about things like cyberloafing, when you're getting paid, but you're not actually working. So, and how, that's kind of constructed. Now, ethicists and scholars, they spend a lot of time considering very difficult situations. And maybe not always coming up with the right answers, but so possible answers or possible solutions. They are going to take this time in evaluating these very complex and competing interests that might be involved in some of these situations. And here we have some examples. So we have a large hydroelectric dam. I believe this one is in China. We have genetically modified food, which we'll devote sort of a whole lecture to later on. We have stem cell research, which, is still controversial in some areas. So, for instance, in the example of the dam, China has these massive damming projects that they've been working on for the past 15 or 20 years. There are all kinds of environmental and cultural issues that get wrapped up in this. Now, they will bring power and other good elements, cheap electricity, ideally, to poorer regions. But they're also extremely disruptive, of course, to the environment. And, in fact, to the communities that they're supposed to be serving. Many, you know, people are forced to leave very quickly their rural areas in order for the dams to be constructed and have very little say in that. So, you know, there are those trade-offs. Conducting human stem cell research also has some benefits, of course. That's why, you know, scientists are interested in that. The United Kingdom recently has an operation that it hopes to use stem cells or human embryonic stem cells for in order to alleviate blindness, or at least types of blindness. So that those are the upsides of being able to do research that way. The downsides, fairly obvious. You know, some people don't like the idea of research being done in this way, and, you know, there are these fears of how the stem cells are harvested, and, you know, whether or not, you know, that we're talking about making or, you know, different types of human beings through gene splicing, whatever it might be. So genetically modified corn is something that we are already eating. If you're eating a lot of corn products, especially, you know, processed foods, you're probably eating this. They are designed by corporations like Monsanto to grow efficiently and effectively, especially paired with their pesticides. But what is the impact of humans and animals eating this, or of displacing non-genetically modified crops? All of this, you know, these are questions. So perfect examples of where it's hard to just see the apparent value or to dismiss them as completely without value. There's a lot of gray area there. A question we might ask, and that has been asked, is whether technologies have morality. This should be kind of interesting, I would think, to most engineers. There was a historian named Langdon Winner who asked this question: do technologies have moralities? And or do they exist outside of human societies, outside of ethics and morality? Are they neutral in a way? He argued, and this is, I believe, back in the 80s, that there were lots of great examples of technologies that were inherently immoral or moral. For instance, he pointed to bridge building and expressways being built on the East Coast in the 1950s, 1960s, that were about moving cars, but they also had a hidden agenda of segregating neighborhoods, making it harder for lower-income minorities to get to beaches, because there were no on-ramps in their particular neighborhoods. And actually, the way that these freeways, these expressways, interfered or cut through the neighborhoods, it actually made it very hard for them to just kind of walk to the beaches. So that was kind of a hidden part of that. Again, Langdon Winner is saying that the adoption of some technologies might actually change society for the worse. So, you know, just developing the technology and thinking through them, you know, is actually an ethical, moral issue. He gives another example of a tomato picking machine. It's extremely efficient, but it's very expensive, and it is going to eventually drive out smaller producers out of business. So, you know, again, a large corporation could afford it, bad for the little guy in some respects. He also argues that there are inherently political technologies, things like atomic power, the atomic bomb, atomic power versus solar power, you know, where an autocratic society versus a populist society, you know, would make those decisions. I mean, a populist society might think that solar power was more moral than atomic power, and vice versa. So anyway, so these things have been thought about before. In your professional lives, you may or may not deal with these kinds of large issues. But one of the goals of this class is to help you think broadly about your role and the work that you do beyond the office, beyond the lab, you know, just in the way that you fit into society. So, and you should be considering the ethical, the social, the political, the environmental implications all throughout. You know, it becomes part of your life. Most engineers feel that their work is supposed to improve the world somehow. Most engineers are believing, or hopefully are believing, that their role is not to do damage. So you're already, hopefully, in that mode of thinking ethically, even if you haven't considered it or not. So we're going to deal with very specific frameworks, but we should start from kind of the gut level, because that is maybe the basic level that often, you know, we use to judge situations. So, and we can do some kind of ethical rules of thumb. So before we kind of start reviewing these basic frameworks or lenses, you know, that's another way to look at it, that others have used to evaluate ethical problems, we'll just kind of do some general kind of crunching here. And this is really important. Unlike equations, unlike lab experiments, you know, whatever assignments that you may be given in school or by the company that you work for, there are no right answers here, just possible answers. There may be answers that you consider to be right for yourself, but I'm not suggesting that any one of these frameworks that we'll talk about is any better than the other. I do want to point out the upsides and the downsides of each. So, but it's ultimately up to you to make a decision on what makes the most sense to you. And in that respect, ethics is ultimately a judgment call. So you're trying to, I guess one way to put it is to find a position that'll help you sleep at night. Be content with the decisions that you've made. And so, you know, you can talk about two very general rules of thumb. Simple. Number one, don't do anything you wouldn't do if your mother, or, again, insert a significant other of some sort, was standing right next to you. You know, somebody that you consider, you know, that you want to impress, somebody that you want, you know, don't want to be disappointed in you. Number two, don't do anything you wouldn't want to appear on 60 Minutes, which is kind of an old way of looking at it, but this was an investigative news program, and I'm going to go into that a little bit more. And we're actually later on in the class going to talk about the kind of the fall of 60 Minutes. But at one point in time, 60 Minutes was considered to be like the main investigative television program, journalism, and set a very high bar, you know, for morality in society. And, you know, people were very worried, you know, to be, you know, looking unethical before the cameras of 60 Minutes. But you could also say, you know, just the nightly news in general, or To Catch a Predator, maybe, I don't know, or maybe just do your favorite media platform. I got some examples down at the bottom of the screen here. You may know about this incident, but Justine Sacco, she was a publicist. She was somebody who was involved in PR in the corporate world. But she also kind of fancied herself as sort of a comedian type person, somebody who was really excited about Twitter and making jokes on Twitter and having a lot of followers. And there was this incident, and this is probably about almost at least 5 or 6 years ago, if not more, where she was about to get on a plane and she decided to tweet out a little missive, you know, a type of joke that a lot of people would probably tell to their friends, not necessarily broadcast in the world, but here it is, you know, the original is her saying, going to Africa, hope I don't get AIDS, just kidding, I'm white. Okay, so, I mean, obviously many people can read that in many different ways, it's being highly sarcastic, but it set Twitter afire. And the people were monitoring this, sort of friends of friends who somehow were connected to Justine Sacco. She just got on a plane and she's going to Africa. She doesn't have access to her Twitter feed, but basically she is raked over the coals by people she does not even know. When she lands, she finds all of this very negative reaction to what she has said. Here's one of her tweets, you know, after the fact. Oh, I guess there's a date down there, the 2013, so about three years ago, saying, you know, that she's been devastated by it. You know, the people are basically calling her worse than Hitler, that type of thing. And, you know, she's been ruined. More than that, she was actually fired. And, you know, she's fired and by, you know, the company that she worked for. She basically, however long these things last, maybe a couple of days, maybe a month or so, became, quote-unquote, the most hated person in the world. And it kind of ruined her emotionally. Now, people probably later forgot about that. You may know about it, but it lasted. Let's put it that way. So, had she been considering these basic ethical rules of thumb, she might have thought twice. You know, and maybe it's very hard in the social media platforms that we have today to think about this. But had she thought about doing this in that major public way, she probably wouldn't have done it. So that's one part of that. And we're going to watch a quick clip here. I was talking about 60 Minutes. Mike Wallace was kind of the main journalist on that show. At least it was his journalistic style that was part of that show. And he died in 2012. But this is like an obit that kind of talks about that talks about how he went about his journalistic career and why people feared 60 Minutes, you know, looking bad in front of the television cameras in some way.
He loved being Mike Wallace. That's what CBS News chairman and 60 Minutes executive producer Jeff Fager said today. He loved the fact that if he showed up for an interview, it made people nervous. Mike Wallace died last night at a care facility in Connecticut at the age of 93. His fellow 60 Minutes correspondent Morley Safer tonight looks back.
He was doing what?
With you.
Why?
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 Really?
When you boiled down a low gravy,
you demanded special treatment.
You needed money.
It's almost an embarrassment, sir, to hear this from you.
What?
What do they want you to do?
Why are you so reluctant? Why?
For half a century, he took on corrupt politicians, scam artists, and bureaucratic bumblers.
Come on out. You don't want to talk to me?
His visits preceded by the four dreaded words, Mike Wallace is here.
I don't understand. They must be ashamed of something.
How are you, sir?
What is this?
This is 60 Minutes.
Wow. I mean, you're a crook.
Doggone, I wish they didn't say that, though.
Father, I want to read you some things.
Mike took to heart the old reporter's pledge to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable.
You're contemptible. I mean, that's not for the family. I'd like you to get out of here.
I'm nosy and insistent.
So insistent, there were very few 20th century icons who did not submit to a Mike Wallace interview. He lectured Vladimir Putin, the president of Russia, on corruption.
To get anything done.
Money.
He lectured Yasser Arafat on violence.
Mr. Chairman, there are Palestinians who would like to kill you.
He asked the Ayatollah Khomeini if he was crazy.
And he calls you, Imam, forgive me, his words, not mine, a lunatic.
So what?
He grappled with Louis Farrakhan.
I think you should keep quiet. Remain strong, because...
And he interviewed Malcolm X shortly before his assassination.
I probably am a dead man.
The show is Nightbeat.
But it was an interview show called Nightbeat, first broadcast in 1956, that Mike remembers fit him like custom-made brass knuckles.
What do you know about that? Who in the United States is qualified? What kind of people are your friends?
We decided, let's ask the irreverent, the abrasive, the who gives a damn question.
Some, like labor leader Mike Quill, had never been spoken to that way.
Gentlemen, I'm simply asking a question.
I'm ready any time you want to repeat the stupid question.
Neither had mobster Mickey Cohen.
You've killed at least one man, or how many more?
60 Minutes, Volume 1, Number 1.
So when 60 Minutes was born in 1968, Mike brought with him his Nightbeat persona and contributed 40 years worth of nosiness, impertinence, and, of course, drama.
Now wait just a moment.
Hold it a minute, goddammit!
Mike loved to mix it up with producers, editors, even his fellow correspondents.
Astonishing what you learn and feel and see along the way. That's why a reporter's job, as you know, is such a joy.
All right, so, I mean, basically the idea there is, I mean, here's this person who sort of invents a style of television journalism, and, you know, it was celebrated for gleefully going after people who were ethically questionable, and you wouldn't want to necessarily be in front of him if you had done something wrong. So, but, you know, just kind of showing how the how the society in general, we've talked about this already, how the society in general might judge you. So let's define some ideas before we go into those specific ethical frameworks that I was talking about. So first, ethics itself. Basically, this is not just a gut feeling. Ethics is more than that. It has to be a little bit more structured. It's a systematic way of considering morality and trying to figure out what is right and what is wrong. So, and that's a big part of what this course is about. Now, morality, it's a little bit different, and it may be a little bit more relative, I suppose, but it's a collection of beliefs, as it says there, of that a society or particular group within that society, even the individual, thinks is right and wrong. So it can vary wildly, obviously, you know, from religious groups, political groups, the difference, you know, between states or countries in a region, you know, so you can do it on the macro level. You can even do it on the individual level. And individuals have, you know, different ways of setting their own morality. That's just a kind of a general perspective. Now, this class is going to deal with two different types of ethics specifically. Descriptive ethics. This is just a description of what a society or what this society may find morally correct and or incorrect. Just basically as it exists. It's just talking about what already is there, not making any judgment about it. Prescriptive or normative ethics is about making a judgment. This is about, you know, you applying a framework and, you know, trying to decide whether it's right or wrong. So again, this class is not telling you what's right or wrong, but it's about using those ethical frameworks to do it. So, a mix of both of those ethical standpoints. So let's keep defining some of our ideas. There is also a difference between something like a test of integrity and a full-blown ethical dilemma, something that's a little harder to crunch. So a test of integrity, basically you know what's right. You know the difference between right and wrong, and you know that maybe you are falling onto the wrong side, but it's still, for whatever reason, somewhat difficult to make that choice. So, for instance, I mentioned this before, cyberloafing, checking your personal email, your Facebook account, going on Reddit or Snapchat or what have you, at work, when you're supposed to be working, and you're getting paid, you know, to work, and it's, there's not a specific company policy that says that every 10 minutes or you know, 5 minutes or whatever, that you can do your own personal stuff. It's not a huge ethical issue, probably, and you could probably look around any office space and see tons of other people doing the same thing. But it is a test of one's integrity, of your kind of moral standpoint, your ethical standpoint. There can be a bigger example within this. And let me just give you a hypothetical. So let's say you're an airplane mechanic, and you're doing routine maintenance on an airplane engine, and you find a flashlight that's been left in an engine cowling. Now, nothing happened. There was no accident, but it could have been pretty bad. You know, had it got sucked up into the engine, whatnot, the engine might have been destroyed. There might have been a fire. You might have scared a lot of people. You might have hurt some people. You might have even killed some people. Luckily, that didn't happen. And yet now you're in a position where you probably should report this. To report it, though, means that the person who did it, and there'll probably be an investigation into that, hopefully, the person who did it is going to get in trouble. They're at the, you know, best, they're going to probably get a severe reprimand. At the worst, they might lose their job. Maybe if it's a military situation, they might be court-martialed and kicked out of the military, so they lose their career in some respect. Here's the other problem. If you're a mechanic, it was likely another mechanic, and it probably is somebody that you know. It may even be a friend of yours. Now, you can choose not to report it, but to not report that would be a breach of proper procedure. And it also might mean that the person who's leaving flashlights and engine cowlings might continue to do it, since they've not been warned against it or they've not been on guard for it. So there might be a future accident. You've seen it here where it didn't cause an accident, but like we said, it could very easily lead to an accident. So you know what's right, but it's kind of hard to make that choice because it could impact your relationships with others. You hopefully are not the type of person who wants to make other people feel bad. You could always probably imagine yourself in the same situation. So that is a test of integrity. So it can be, you know, on many different levels. Now, a test of integrity is one thing. An ethical dilemma, on the other hand, is much harder to determine right from wrong, given the particulars of the situation. It's harder to determine what the course of action should be as well. So here's where an ethical framework really is supposed to help you. So one scenario, you're a student worker, an intern, maybe employed for the summer by an environmental engineering consulting firm. And the lead engineer, someone, a much older person, probably someone who has probably been working for the corporation for many years, asks you to take samples from chemical drums that are happen to be stored on the property of a client. And you're pretty sure that they contain hazardous waste. They're icky looking, right? They smell bad. There's all kinds of nasty stuff dripping down the sides. You even see some dead, you know, squirrels and possums or whatnot around there that probably were killed by drinking whatever was leaking out of there. You also know, having had sufficient training, that hazardous waste must be reported to federal and state authorities so that transportation of such waste is safe, so that it's not continually do damage. You also know that it's far more expensive to dispose of hazardous waste than conventional waste. All of these steps have to be taken. Now this person is your boss, basically, is telling you, don't worry, we just need to take the samples. We don't need to analyze them. This is an important client. We don't want them to get in trouble or cost them more money. It could be bad for them and it could be bad for us. And remember, you're just a summer employee or an intern, somebody maybe who, you know, really doesn't have a stake in the corporation in any way, shape, or form. And your boss says, we're just going to suggest to our client that they remove these drums and let the client deal with it. It's not our issue. We just need to do these kind of basic samples. So this is how it's done in the world of work. You are a student. You're an intern. You don't know this yet. We do it all the time. So the ethical dilemma here is, do you show loyalty to your employer? Do you defer to their expert opinion? You know, maybe what you're getting from them is something that sounds a little old-fashioned, but you're thinking, okay, well, they know. Or do you, having been versed in the law and have a sense of what's important to society, do you uphold the law, responsibility of society, go over your boss's head and whistleblow? We're going to spend a lot of time talking about whistleblowing later on. There's a whole lecture basically going to be devoted to that. But that's an ethical dilemma. It's not something that's easy, very easy to make the choice, at least a snap judgment, unless you've thought about it. You know, kind of crunch this through an ethical framework. I'll give you another example, a military example. Here's the other photograph here. So let's say there's an army unit in Afghanistan, and they fire on enemy forces that are just over a ridge. You know, they know where they are. Later on, when they go and inspect the site where they fired on, they find that they've accidentally shelled a home that they couldn't see before. It was behind a rock or something like that, and it wasn't visible, and they've injured several children. There are civilian casualties in this. So they set about what they need to do. They have a medical team, and they start administering medical aid. And right in the middle of that, before they've really had any time to do anything about it, to help these civilians, non-combatants, they are suddenly given new orders to leave the site, and they need to give medical aid because they have this ability to another army unit, one of their own units that has just come under fire. They know that if they leave, they are neglecting civilians, the people that they're fighting to protect, supposedly. And then these children might die if they leave. If they stay, they are disobeying orders, and their fellow soldiers may die. So they're between a rock and a hard place here. The officer leading the patrol has to make a choice, and there doesn't seem to be any good options. Immediately, you know, somebody is going to get the worst end of things. an ethical theory, an ethical framework, is there or should be in place to help the officer kind of make that decision, so that they don't have to cobble something out of air. And that set of tools is going to get them past, and you past, if you have one, an impasse. You know, something where, you know, you're just kind of stuck like a deer in the headlights. Ethical decisions are often difficult because they may be dealing with competing considerations, or quite simply because no choice seems to be a good one, or completely satisfying for that matter. Or perhaps every option has these big, big, big downsides. Sometimes you'll face a decision that is both a test of integrity and an ethical dilemma at the same time. The right thing may become apparent, but pressures to not do the right thing may be equally daunting. So because it may be unpopular in a small group or in the larger society, it may mean costing you money, your family money, costing you a job, costing others a job, their money. Or there may be a pressure of going along with whatever the issue is, putting up with the problem, because you might get something out of it. You might be rewarded, you know, for loyalty or whatever it might be. So those are all real pressures that humans face. And given that we're all humans here, you know, we have to acknowledge that. So we're going to look at 5 major ethical frameworks that have been worked out. Some of them are thousands of years old. Some of them are a little bit newer. So 5 major ethical frameworks and 2 subsets of those ethical frameworks that have been employed. Most of these are in the textbook, but at least 2 are not, and I'll point out which ones are not in the textbook. So the first one we're going to start with is known as utilitarianism, and which is a subset in itself of consequentialism, but we'll just kind of stick with calling it utilitarianism. All right, so utilitarianism within this is basically to focus on the best possible consequences. That's a common way of approaching any kind of ethical dilemma, is look for what would be the best possible thing to happen. This is probably one of the most common ethical frameworks out there, weighing the consequences and looking for the best result. So that larger idea is known as consequentialism, but the dominant theory that kind of comes out of the consequences, the consequentialism, is utilitarianism. And this was really developed by this guy in the glass cabinet here. His name is Jeremy Bentham. He was a philosopher. He was also an industrialist, so he's not just somebody who lived in an ivory tower. He actually worked in the real world, saw the real world implications of work. He's the father of utilitarianism. He's born in the 1740s, around the time that the Industrial Revolution is getting going in England, and he dies in around 1832, so extremely old for his time. Most men probably didn't live past 50, and he lives to be almost 100 years old. Now, even though he's dead, you can visit him today. See this? That's not just a statue of him behind that glass case. That is actually his body preserved as what they call an auto icon at the University College in London. Basically, this is part of his, you know, moral perspective on life and death and human remains and all of that. But when he knew he was going to die, he had his body donated to the university so that students could study the human body. He also wanted to show that it was just a corpse. There was nothing magical about the body afterwards. And so he had his best friend, a guy named Dr. Southwood Smith, dissect him in front of his other friends in the middle of a medical lab, basically. And apparently, as the story goes, during the dissection, there was a terrible thunderstorm that lit up the entire chamber, lots of lightning, and it was super kind of a spooky moment in some respects. So there were probably some of his friends there questioning whether or not, you know, that they were dealing with supernatural forces. Bentham would have said absolutely not. And he wanted to prove that this was just dead tissue. He also asked that after this dissection was over that his body be, quote-unquote, defleshed, and that his skeleton be stuffed and padded and put into these clothes that you see and put on display with a wax head. So that's not his actual head. That's a wax head. Although they did save the real head. It is there. It's decayed too much to put on display, but the university still has it. So, but it's all safe and sound at the University College of London. Anyway, so that's the guy who comes up with this theory. Sometimes important to know who's coming up with these ideas. Bentham's ideas, they spring from this surge of secularism in society, you know, moving away from religion that happens, you know, in England and other areas around the time of the Industrial Revolution in the late 1700s and throughout the 19th century. With the idea that if God was no longer defining the right and wrong, how do you define right and wrong? It's still important. So if you don't turn to your religion to do it, and that's not to say that a lot of people did still turn to the religion, but there was more and more people who were moving away from that. How do you determine right and wrong? So Bentham saw that all people had these two masters. So that's what he thought, that there were these two masters of all people, pain and pleasure. One is bad, pain. The other is good, pleasure, in general. And so he comes up with this idea that one should seek to basically minimize pain and maximize pleasure. And this is, you know, known as the idea of the greatest happiness principle. His quote was, "The greatest happiness for the greatest number." Okay, so maximize happiness is the idea. So his utilitarian theory under that is the rightness or wrongness of actions can be determined by the overall amount of happiness that the actions are expected to produce in any given circumstance. So right is useful. The right things are useful to society, to people. The wrong things are damaging to people. Takeaway, they have the opposite of use. The right thing to do in every situation, according to Bentham, is to maximize happiness, or what he called utility. So he's also going to call it the utility principle. For the greatest numbers of people, maximize utility. Nothing in this framework is ruled out. There may be situations where lying, cheating, torture, stealing, even murder would be justified if somehow maximizing happiness was the result. So a utilitarian might look at a expected results and argue the ends always justify the means and give these normally unethical actions the stamp of approval. For example, we might think in society, murder always, always, always wrong. Let's say, however, and this is something that science fiction authors have dealt with, but let's say that we create a time machine and you all of a sudden can go back in time and someone might say, well, let's go back in time and shoot Hitler. Let's kill Hitler. No Holocaust, no World War II, at least not as it plays out. Or maybe even go back further, slightly further in time and shoot baby Hitler. Generally, we don't think killing babies is a good idea, but let's say you have all the facts and you're able to wipe out, you know, one of the 20th century's greatest mass murderers. So that is, you know, an extreme example of how you can justify different actions given the maximizing of happiness that will be the result of that. Much more prosaic and much more realistic to what society would deal with would be how a government should spend its tax dollars, something like that. You know, nobody wants to necessarily pay taxes, but you're maximizing the best results for society by doing it. Now, the textbooks point out, as does ours, that utilitarianism seeks to balance the good and the bad consequences of a given situation, and it tries to, although it's nearly impossible in reality, but it tries to consider or take into account all of the perspectives of all the people involved. So in some ways, decision-making process, no one is going to be completely happy. But hopefully no one is going to be completely outraged at the end. So it's really about compromise. It's not about maximizing your personal well-being necessarily. It attempts to balance the good of the whole against the good of the individuals. If it makes you happy, but it makes the vast majority of people unhappy, or it doesn't maximize utility or whatever you want to call it, don't do it. So Bentham thought utility might even be reduced down to a mathematical equation somehow. And you see this kind of trotted out now, in you know modern times. But the idea, his idea was that there would be these things called eudals and hedons, and you know those were his basic units of measurement. You know, eudals being things that are good, hedons are things that are damaging necessarily. So most people backed away from this mathematical formula, but it's interesting. You know, how do we do that? If you're looking at that, how do we weigh the utility of a chocolate bar against the utility of a beautiful vista or of a song that we really like or a hug or something? So, I mean, again, it's interesting, but it's probably pretty hard to put a value on it, you know, whatever those things are at a given time, without really going down a rabbit hole. Now, John Stuart Mill, the other individual here with the this black and white photograph in the center here, he is more, even more of a poster boy of utilitarianism, and did a lot to develop it after Jeremy Bentham is gone. But he also is very nuanced in the way that he approaches it. So he was, at the very young age, groomed to be this intellectual philosopher by his father. He actually had been tutored by Bentham. You know, he was a genius, really. I mean, he was reading Greek. He's English, but he was reading Greek by the age of 3, ancient Greek. He had mastered most of what was known at the time, and we're talking about the early 19th century. Late 18th century, mastered what was most was known in math and political philosophy. By the time that he was 11 years old, grade school. However, you know, sometimes it happens with geniuses. He was emotionally wrought, and he actually had a nervous breakdown at the age of 20. And after this breakdown, he comes to believe that it's impossible to only live by the math of utilitarianism that Bentham had created, which was very unemotional, and that without feelings, without emotions, we'd actually go crazy, and we're not human. And so he kind of restores himself after this breakdown and comes up with fleshing out utilitarianism, comes up with the idea of the greatest happiness principle. This puts intellectual pressure over... puts intellectual pleasure over mere physical pleasures. So pleasure is important, but there are different types of pleasure. And so as part of that, he enunciates the idea that it is better to be a dissatisfied human than a satisfied pig. So if you're just, your pleasures are all about eating and, you know, just kind of like base desires, that's not as good as it would be if you were achieving some kind of intellectual pleasure level there. So he also comes up with the idea of the harm principle. This is what is most associated with John Stuart Mill. Act as you want to, but do no harm to others. So that's really one way to look at it. So in popular culture, we have these ideas too. Mr. Spock from Star Trek has a form of utilitarianism in one of his sayings, the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few or the one. There is actually also a science fiction story called Those Who Walk Away from Omelas, written by Ursula Le Guin, that kind of goes into this idea where people, once they mature in this kind of fantasy society, are shown how the society really works. It's a utopia, apparently, but in order for it to be a utopia, for whatever reason, there is a small, deformed child that is chained up in a basement somewhere that gets tortured. And when you come of age and you're exposed to this reality of what is, for whatever reason, is making your society this perfect utopia, this torturing of this one small individual, you have to make a decision. Do you stay, knowing that that's what behind everything that's so great about the society? Or do you leave and go off into the unknown? And so, of course, the story is about those who walk away from the society. So in that choice, it's kind of the backwards. It's everybody is happy except for this one poor individual. And so utilitarian would say that's perfectly fine, at least in a strict definition of it. John Stuart Mill might say, no, do no harm is not being enacted there. So different wrinkles. Anyway, utilitarianism is as a framework for us, it is very popular, but it is also very demanding. Technically, you have to take into account everybody's well-being into it, or who at least those who are being affected by some course of action that you might be taking. Now, should we weigh all happiness equally, or just higher pleasures? Again, that was where John Stuart Mill is saying, you know, it's not just about base happiness, it's about the higher forms of pleasure, whatever that might be. There's also some big problems with, you know, other than it being hard to assess everybody's feelings, there's some problems with utilitarianism in that it overlooks individuals' rights or concerns. It makes rules for minorities carried out by majorities. So in the world of the civil rights movement, you know, that would not be taken into account because technically I'm a minority movement, or at least that was one perspective of it. Eugenics, if you've ever heard of this before, this was this idea of forced sterilization, forced contraception, birth control, sometimes even in extreme examples of putting people to death because they have bad genes. And this was a really popular movement, not just in Nazi Germany in the 1930s, but actually in the United States in the early 20th century, before World War II. And it was generally led against immigrant societies, against the poorer classes. It was led by the upper middle class and the elite classes. And again, things like sterilizing the poor or immigrants in general, banning alcohol to stop drunkenness, you know, with the idea that, you know, there needed to be much more of a nanny state in deciding what people could and couldn't do. So that's overlooking individual minority rights. Also, again, how do you measure happiness or the most good, especially if you don't know what the outcomes are going to be? You know, you cannot predict the future. You can only guess at what it is. So there are the question of unforeseen long-term, unintended consequences. What one society finds good, you know, at one time, 100 years later, might be looked at as being absolutely abominable, right? Again, eugenics. You know, we would not practice that necessarily today. There could be also counterintuitive outcomes. If enough people in this class derived, you know, the class that we're in, if you derived happiness from seeing the TA and myself engage in gladiator-style combat to the death, right here, you know, in the classroom, apparently, according to utilitarianism, that would be ethically okay and would override the suffering that my TA or myself might face, right? I mean, unless you're going by John Stuart Mill's idea about not doing any harm. That allowance for that type of occurrence, potentially, is problematic. So there is a philosopher whose name was Karl Popper, who was important in the early 20th century, mid-20th century. He believed that utilitarianism was the path to terror, was the path to totalitarianism. He thought that it was not only impossible, but that it was actually extremely dangerous to go down the path of what's good for the majority over the minority. He advocated it instead of the principles of utilitarianism that Bentham and Mill come up with, that having something known as negative utilitarianism, if you're going to go there, and focusing more on minimizing pain over maximizing happiness. So, you know, kind of upending it. So again, you know, kind of reversing things. That said, utilitarianism is a very appealing way to approach ethics. Consequences do matter, and this approach is essentially neutral. It's only about utility, right? But it can, you know, produce counterintuitive outcomes. And moreover, outcomes are hard to predict in advance, and utility is hard to calculate. So, like I said, very influential, but unfortunately here, human beings have been shown to be pretty bad at making consequentialist calculations, especially when our own self-interest is something we can't escape. Our own self-interest is involved. Our minds get clouded by emotional responses quite easily. And so it's probably best to walk away, or at least consider other ethical approaches. Now, a subset of utilitarianism, because it's so popular in that it does help you arrive at decisions is something called the cost-benefit analysis. So an application of utilitarianism. In CBA, cost-benefit analysis, the costs are weighed against the benefits. Seems simple, cut and dried, seems very objective. Corporations love and use cost-benefit analysis every day because it assigns numbers, dollar amounts to particular things. And corporations understand money. We've talked about this already. We'll continue to talk about it throughout the class. But that is kind of like a basic conceit of a corporation, is they're in it for the money. They're in it for the numbers. Of course, there's huge drawbacks. It is kind of hard, as we've mentioned already, with the idea of utilitarianism, to put a price on certain things, like human life. You know, how much is that worth? And yet, under cost-benefit analysis, there are different institutions and entities that have put a value to human life. The U.S. government values human life, at least in terms of war and the military, at around $600,000. So if you are killed in combat, your next of kin can be paid up to $600,000. If a soldier, in the case of a soldier losing his or her life. Safety analysts, they also use a cost-benefit analysis. They say that $5 million is a reasonable amount to pay in the event of an accident that causes death. Medicare will pay about $129,000 in the event of malpractice that leads to death. Ford, and we talked about this in the first lecture, but Ford in the infamous Pinto fires and accidents that happened in 1971, they crunched the numbers and they felt that $200,000 per loss of life was more reasonable. Remember, this is behind the scenes, but it was more reasonable than spending $20 million to fix all the cars. So they would just go and wait for people to sue them, pretty much. And here we have on the screen there is this kind of calculation. You know, productivity loss that people, you know, would be reasonable to incur. Indirect hospital costs, you know, victims' pain and suffering, however they put that at $10,000, whatnot. Did they come up with this price of just over $200,000? If you've seen the movie Fight Club, and I know it's from the 90s, but you really should see this movie. If you see the movie Fight Club, this is the main character. Basically, what he does is he works. He's a bean counter who works and calculates, you know, how much it would cost a corporation to get sued versus, you know, fixing a problem that they might have with their cars or whatever it might be. So, great for a corporation in that it gets them past the impasse of not being able to make a decision, but looks pretty cold. If you are building a dam and you're using a cost-benefit analysis, you can assign a value to hydroelectricity very easily. There's a dollar value you can put to that. But it's a little bit harder to assign a value to a scenic view, as we talked about before, or environmental disruption or cultural disruption or whatever that might be. So in the 1930s through the 1960s, in this country at least, there were lots and lots of dams being built. Here we have a picture of Hoover Dam, which was built in the middle of the Great Depression. Damming rivers was good for producing cheap hydroelectric power, but it disrupted wild salmon populations and prevented spawning. Maybe it wasn't as valued during the Depression when people needed jobs and cheap power, or at least that was valued over environmental concerns later on, though, especially as we get into, you know, the days of Earth Day and in the environmental movement of the late 1960s and early 70s. There was a big undamming movement that starts and is still continuing to this day. But that in itself, just ripping out the dams, has its own set of disruptions. A lot of the dams have been in place for decades and decades now, and you know, you're going to impact people economically. So, but a simple cost-benefit analysis dealing with that ethical dilemma would weigh the cost of the dam against the amount of hydroelectric power or irrigation it would provide. You know, that's generally what they're looking at. They may try to crunch some other numbers, but it's really hard to capture other issues, like how to assign a dollar value to the environment when no one actually pays for the environment. How much is a sunset worth? How much is a a beautiful night or beautiful, you know, a fishing excursion or being on a beautiful lake. Let's put it that way. Lots of diffuse cost there. Less clean water versus cheap energy. Declining salmon population, you know, versus a more navigable waterway, whatever it might be. Higher cancer risks for some people, you know, maybe who are closer to the dam or whatnot, or if they decide not to build the dam and putting different kind of power structures elsewhere, that might cause, you know, other environmental issues. It looks simple, but it can be very hard. So cost-benefit analysis, one of the big problems is it just basically comes to a quick decision often without really, really, really thinking about the long-term consequences. Okay, so that's utilitarianism and its subset cost-benefit analysis. Now let's talk about deontological or what they call duty ethics. Deontological, that term comes from Latin for that which is binding. So it's supposed to, you know, be about codes, things that you bind yourself to and direct you in a certain direction or in a certain course of action. So it's supposed to help avoid the messiness of utilitarianism and the self-interest that are involved if you offload your interests onto a set of codes that have been developed and that you are agreeing to adhere to. Honor codes and sets of ethical rules are like this. So, for instance, at West Point, the military academy, they have an honor code that's very simple, and this is what the cadets learn almost immediately. A cadet will not lie, cheat, steal, or tolerate those who do. You know, fairly cut and dried. Stick to that ethical framework, and you should be good. You can also think of things like the Ten Commandments. You know, follow these 10 rules, and you'll be awesome, right? You know, you'll be an awesome person if you follow those. Any professional society as well. If you're a member of one, maybe you know these. If you're thinking about becoming a member of a professional society, you might notice that they have, you know, maybe 10, maybe 100 different ethical commandments or rules. Now, duty ethics maintains that there are duties, basically, that should be performed. Like, again, these could be these elements in your honor code, treating others fairly, not injuring others. Things that we see, you know, popping up in utilitarianism, but a little bit more very specifically noted. So that's what you should do, regardless of whether or not these acts, and this is how it differs from utilitarianism, regardless of whether or not these acts lead to the most good or the optimal result for society. So any action which injures someone should not be done, even if it brings about larger social benefits. So we have this idea of animal testing that PETA and other groups are against. And PETA is very militant about being against animal testing. No experimentations, is what they argue, on animals whatsoever are acceptable, even in the pursuit of a cure for cancer or what diseases, what have you. You know, anything that afflicts human society, you cannot do experiments on animals. PETA also says that animals are not ours to eat or to wear, you know, much less experiment on, or to use for our entertainment. So PETA would even be against pets in some respects, probably. Now, that is a modern example. An example from the ancient world and from ancient literature is the example of Odysseus. If you know the story, Odysseus is going on all of these travels, an odyssey, right? That's where this comes from, of course. And he, at one point in time, is beset by the sirens who are, you know, tempting men and sailors to, you know, run into the rocks. No one can avoid their temptations. So he has all of his crew put wax in their ears so that they can't hear the sirens. And he has himself bound to the mast of his ship. So in this scenario, the siren song is akin to the temptations of self-interest, of the things that we want to do because they make us happy, probably base happiness, you know, the hedonistic happiness. But we are tying ourselves to the mast in like we are wedding ourselves to deontological codes. If we, like Odysseus, bind ourselves to certain code, we are less likely to make a poor ethical choice and more likely to stick to our ethical beliefs. Now, in the world of philosophy and how this really gets developed in the modern world, it's Immanuel Kant, the German philosopher who is pretty much the poster boy here. A lot of these philosophies have a different poster boy. John Stuart Mill and Jeremy Bentham for utilitarianism, here Immanuel Kant. And he was one of the most important Western philosophers. You know, he wrote about a lot of things, especially about the idea of individual liberty and the ability to make free choices. Well, that's one of his biggest. Has a lot to do with the development later on of the Declaration of Independence in the United States. So it's kind of a foundational. He's considered part of the DNA of a foundational document of American values, whatever those might be. In coming up with duty ethics, Kant began by asking, what should I do? And his answer very quickly was act morally. So what should I do? You act morally. So when faced with an ethical dilemma, he threw us a guide rope in the cluster of principles known as the categorical imperative. And there's two real big parts to that, which we'll go through. But the categorical imperative in general, the umbrella, basically says follow these principles, and that is the most important ethical duty. So Kant puts us at the center of a moral philosophy, asking us what can we do. So we are at the center, very specific to us. And this is important because being able to choose actions is what makes us human, right? We have the freedom of choice, or we should have the freedom of choice. We are not just acting out of instincts like animals do, or just base desires, hopefully. We have constructed laws. We have, created governments. We are not just content to follow the laws of nature, kill or be killed, eat when food is around, or, when you can kill, or whatever it might be. We have bound ourselves by the laws of society, and this is actually free will. We have made that choice. Now, Kant argues that moral duties were fundamental, universal principles, things that could be applied anywhere. Seems pretty simple. Things like be honest. Don't make other people suffer. Be fair to other people. Those are pretty universal qualities in general. If you follow those basic principles and others like them, you're being ethical. That's how you know you're making ethical decisions. So as part of the categorical imperative, this larger umbrella, part one is universalism, or making it universal. It's supposed to give us a guide on how we use our freedom to act morally. So according to Kant, you should act only according to that maxim, this is a quote, whereby you can at the same time will that it should be a universal law. So the way that you're acting, you ask yourself, would this be okay if the actions that I'm taking would be universalized? If I am stealing someone's lunch out of the refrigerator at work, would I be okay if everyone stole everyone's lunch? Probably not. On a much bigger scale, in wartime, if you're trying to make the decision, is it ethical to drop bombs on civilian centers, sparing no churches, schools, hospitals, daycare centers, whatever it is, right? People's homes. Would I be okay if the enemy were dropping bombs on my churches, my schools, my hospitals, my homes? According to that, probably not. You probably would not want to universalize that behavior. So if not, then this would not be universalizable and therefore not ethical. Pretty easy. Now, this is not the same thing as the golden rule, which is, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Kant actually rebutted this, and he said that a murderer might trot out the golden rule before a judge, appealing to the judge saying, hey, you don't want to be executed, so I don't want to be executed. So that it's too simplistic, the golden rule. Basically, though, he's saying, to decide whether or not it would be ethical. If the judge committed a crime similar to the murderer, would he be judged in the same way? Now, the categorical imperative number two, second part of this, is respect. Act in such a way, according to Kant, this is a quote again, act in such a way that you treat humanity, whether in your own person or in the person of another, never merely as the means to an end, but always at the same time as an end. So, in other words, we should respect one another's freedom to make our own choices. Everybody is making their own choices, and we should respect the freedom that they have to do that. The core of human dignity is to see other humans as rational, reasoning agents, not as animals, not as others that you need to make decisions for, maybe as their children, but, you know, obviously once they're adults, then it should be perfectly fine. So slaves, according to this rationale, slaves are unable to live according to their own rationality and free choices. And so slavery, under the categorical imperative that Kant elaborates on, should, you know, slavery should be considered unethical. Because slaves are always being used merely as a means to an end, merely as a way to get profits for the slave owners. So deontological duty ethics had a lot to do, eventually, with the ending of slavery in the West. So Immanuel Kant is huge. He's really important because his ideas are important to the fundamentals of our modern world. I mentioned that American democracy, the Bill of Rights, and the Declaration of Independence have a lot to do with these ideas of duty. The First Amendment, you know, you can just point to that in the Constitution. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. That owes a lot to Kant's philosophy. However, like consequentialism, like utilitarianism that we talked about before, Kant's categorical imperative can take us down some really dangerous roads. For instance, if you say that lying universally should not be okay ethically, and it fails those two elements, the two parts of the categorical imperative, universal and respect, you know, it's always wrong, then you can never see a time when it is okay, ethically okay, to tell a lie. But I'm sure you could imagine times when it probably is necessary to tell a lie. What about it when, you know, for use another extreme example, what about when the secret police shows up looking for a political dissident? Whether it be right now or maybe back in during World War II. You know, we always have this tendency maybe to go back to World War II. Should Anne Frank, should her neighbors have turned her in? Would it be ethical? No one really knows, actually, who turned Anne Frank in. But if they were believers in Kant's idea of the categorical imperative, they were followers, and they were asked, have there or are there any Jews hiding here by the Nazi soldiers? They would have felt that it was unethical to lie and therefore that tell, you know, the soldiers where she was hiding if they knew. An extreme example, sure, but ethical frameworks are only as good as they can deal with these extreme examples. So that's why we trot out a lot of extreme examples. The best ethical frameworks have flexibility, and deontological ethics, because you're bound to that mast, you're bound to these codes. That's why they're popular, because they have this strong set of codes, lack flexibility. So this is one of the drawbacks, maybe, of just sticking to deontological ethics or duty ethics. Now, there's rights ethics as well, somewhat related. It emphasizes that we all have moral rights and that any action that violates these rights is unethical and unacceptable. So poster boy here would be John Locke, again, really important to American democracy. He comes up with the principle of natural rights, you know, that we are all born with inherent rights, no matter what station in life we are, whether we're born poor or in a middling class or we're born into royalty. Again, he's talking about his time. Those ideas are interpreted in the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, is what Thomas Jefferson says. So Thomas Jefferson is a student of John Locke's, and these ideas of rights being very important. So it underlies also a lot of social movements that happen later on. So a follower of Thomas Jefferson and John Locke is Martin Luther King Jr. And here he is going to jail for his beliefs in the 1950s. So it was a big part of the civil rights movement of that time period. Of course, the civil rights movement is calling to an end to racial discrimination against African Americans, and technically everybody, but African Americans specifically at the time. Things that prevented, you know, social situations prevented them from voting, from holding certain jobs, certain offices, from attaining an education, from living in different areas. So that is arguing for rights that all individuals have. Sounds great. And it is, of course, but there are some problems with both rights and duty ethics that we already talked about, and these kind of come into conflict here. So there's no way to resolve these conflicts, really, between rights or duties. What if the rights of one individual or one group conflict with those of another? Plenty of examples within it. So the black and white photograph you see there, that is a Pulitzer Prize winning photograph from the 1970s. It's a horrific photograph of a black protester about to be impaled by a white protester in Boston, you know, by an American flag. I mean, it says so much, of course. And this is, the protest is over busing, school busing in the 1970s. And this is a playing out from the civil rights movement. One of the issues was about segregation of schools. You may know that. It takes decades for the schools to become desegregated. And how do you actually accomplish that? You know, how do you practically accomplish desegregation when people live in different parts of different cities that may be, have de facto segregation? So the plan was basically to start busing kids from the inner city to schools that were predominantly white and vice versa. Bus white kids from suburban schools to inner city schools. That was the idea, at least in Boston and in some other communities, that that was how they're going to balance that out. The problems were, well, you know, what the problems that they're trying to solve are pretty clear. You know, segregation is bad. The problems with doing it this way, their solution, were also pretty clear fairly quickly. Kids who were taking these bus rides, both the white kids and the black kids, were on the buses for up to 2 hours each way. So a four-hour commute every day generally didn't give them time to do homework, at least in a controlled environment. They often were excluded from extracurricular activities like sports and clubs. Parents who lived 2 hours away from the schools their students were being bused to couldn't take part in after-school activities, in the PTA, whatever it might be. There was a loss of local control of the schools. You know, they didn't really have a lot of say because they couldn't very easily kind of investigate what was going on in the various schools. That's a huge issue in American schooling, is local control. And it, you know, in the larger scheme of things, it pits the rights of poor inner-city kids for them to get a good education against the rights of all kids and against the rights of suburban, often white kids, to attend a nearby academically like a stronger school. Now, you make an argument that one is more important than the other, then, of course, you're going down maybe a utilitarianism path, but you can see that there are people who are going to be losing out from it. And so if you're just saying people have rights and we have duties to uphold certain ideals, you know, you see how it's not always apparent. To give an engineering example, which is the photograph of that conduit, that tunnel and that conduit down there, in 2002, President Bush finally, and Congress, working with Congress, finally made a decision about where the United States was going to store the bulk of its nuclear waste. And so they picked a mountain called Yucca Mountain. All of America's spent nuclear fuel was going to be put in this repository in a hollowed out mountain in Nevada, a very ugly mountain. Was, you know, obviously there's different values about what's pretty and what's ugly, but most people didn't look at that mountain as being a natural wonder or anything like that. It was just a desolate mountain in the desert in Nevada, in a state in which very few people live compared to some other states. The state and Las Vegas, which was a nearby community to, you know, it's within the shadow of Yucca Mountain, they filed a lawsuit, several lawsuits actually, but they all lost. But what you had there was your competing rights and interests being put together, right? So, or being pitted against one another. So the broad public good of having a safe, singular site to dispose of some of the most hazardous material known to man was a good thing, right? You put it all in one central location so that it can be overseen by the Department of Energy. One facility meant there would be much more careful oversight, a lot less likelihood that, you know, systems would break down if it's all in one site. Fairly remote. It is within the shadow of Las Vegas, but it really is out in the middle of the desert. There's not a lot of, you know, communities right next to it. The land was owned already by the federal government, and they weren't really doing very much with it. So the Department of Energy owned some land, the Air Force, the Bureau of Land Management owned it. In a remote location, there was a much more reduced risk of public exposure and not as much animal life, maybe not the animal life that we care about, you know, tarantulas and whatnot, but being exposed to it. However, there was a huge backlash against it in the form of what we call NIMBYism, which is an acronym meaning not in my backyard. And people in Nevada did not want trains and trucks full of nuclear waste being shipped through to Yucca Mountain. How do you actually get it to this remote location? What happens if a train derails? What happens if it happens right in the middle of Las Vegas, where you do have you know, a population of millions? And not only that, of course, it can harm people. It also disrupt commerce. Las Vegas is an economic center of Nevada. So those different rights and duties, I suppose, were pitted against each other. The Obama administration, when Obama took over in 2009, basically killed the plan for Yucca Mountain. All right, so people of Las Vegas are protected, and then Nevada in general, from potential accidents. However, no solution has been come up with what we're supposed to do with our nuclear waste. So what they do with most nuclear waste is store it in rather comparatively unsecure containers outside of each nuclear reactor. And, you know, again, the reason why you didn't want that to happen was because each little community that's near a nuclear reactor might actually suffer if there was an accident. So, you know, no solution, basically. That was the best that they could come up with. We'll talk about this more when we watch a film that deals with how the Danish, I believe it's the Danish, how they decided to deal with their nuclear waste and some of the engineering applications of that. Now, another problem with duty and rights ethics, neither theory accounts for public good very well. So how do we weigh the social good against the rights of the duties of individuals and whatnot? So again, they're in conflict with each other. That's a problem. Let's consider here a classical ethical scenario considering utilitarianism versus duty ethics, or the deontological approaches, and with some rights ethics thrown in. You may know this. It's pretty famous. You probably got this in junior high in some respect. But scenario number one, there's a runaway trolley. Not that we see a lot of trolleys anymore, but let's just say there's a runaway trolley or a train, you know, whatever. It is a big public transportation device of some sort. Now, you are in a position where you see an accident about to happen. You don't have time, or maybe you're not within, you know, distance of being able to warn any of the people who are in harm's way. You are, however, in a position that you can, for whatever reason, you miraculously find yourself standing next to the mechanism that controls which way the trolley goes. It's on tracks, right? So you can shift it from one set of tracks to another. So in one, if it keeps going just the way that it's going, it's going to take out five people. If you shift it to the other track, it's going to take out one person. Remember, let's say these people don't see the trolley coming and you can't warn them. So if you're a utilitarianist, you would say, kill the one person. Simple as that. Five people are worth more, very clearly, than one person's life. So that's basic. I mean, obviously there's some problems with that, but let's go on to the second scenario. Second scenario is this. It's even more fraught. In this one, you don't have access to a lever to You know, stop the trolley, this trolley that's out of control. The only way that you can stop the train or the trolley or the van or whatever it is that's, you know, barreling down on, and it's going to kill five people, is to throw a large man on the tracks. You're just going to push this guy out in front of the trolley. His body weight will derail the trolley, and you will save people's lives, but you are in the process committing murder in order to save others. It may seem different than scenario number one, right? The scenario number one may seem different from that, but you are, it's really no different because you are actively making a choice of switching. It's just the technical aspects of it. Both scenarios, of course, have problems. What if the five people are convicted murderers that, you know, you're trying to save? So they already have, you know, violated the rules of society, or pedophiles, or Wall Street bankers, or whoever your bad guy is, right? Okay, so what if the fat guy, for lack of a better term, what if the large man is the guy who sabotaged the trolley in the first place? He was the one who made it so that the trolley would go out of control, and he's down there watching it, getting this kind of murderous glee out of watching people about to be wiped away. You know, maybe he's a terrorist or something. I don't know. That's another way to put it. So a lot depends on your ethical viewpoint in this. You know, maybe you can make that argument that, you know, committing murder by your inaction or by your action is okay. There's actually a document that I've uploaded that talks about, you might think that this is so far beyond the realm of, you know, what humans are going to have to deal with, and after all, it is just a hypothetical situation, but there's an article that I've uploaded that talks about this process when it comes to self-driving cars and how programmers should program those cars. Should the cars be programmed to, let's say, in a given situation, wipe out five people crossing the road, or drive the car off a cliff or into a wall, killing the driver instead? So that is where, you know, we actually might have to deal with these in the real world, and where engineers would have to deal with them. So let's go into virtue ethics. Most of what we've been talking about has had to do with actions, the acts that we take, the choices that we make in navigating the world. Virtue ethics is much more about character, about the types of people we want to be. This is an ancient philosophy, especially in the West, derived from Plato and Aristotle, kind of two foundational figures in the creation of Western philosophy and science as well, too. The question basically is not what should I do, as it is, what should I be? So what type of person should I be? So the notion of virtue, it sounds really old-fashioned. Like I said, it's linked to these ancient philosophers. However, we do award people for their virtues. Society will give people medals, like, for instance, the Congressional Medal of Honor that you see there, for courage, for valor, for gallantry. So we're awarding the virtue. It may be based on the actions that are taken, but the actions are somehow based on this virtuous behavior. Plato and Aristotle, like I said, central to the foundations of Western ethical thought and philosophy and science, they were looking for something called eudaimonia, which translates as the good life. And they both felt that who we are and who we become was more important than any single action that we would take in any given situation. This is a much more holistic approach to creating a good person. Overall, our goal should be to seek excellence of character, or ultimate goodness, to find the best, you know, possible ultimate goodness within ourselves. So we would focus on traits that make for excellence of character, and those traits are called virtues. Bad character traits are known as vices. So we want to avoid vices. Plato, when he was working this out originally, came up with four main virtues in his book, The Republic. He talked about prudence being one of them, justice another, a third virtue being fortitude, and the last virtue is temperance. That says a lot about the time period in which he was living and the society in which he was living in. Aristotle, a student of Plato's, His main virtue was reasoning, you know, using the faculties of intellectual thought. He likened the pursuit of excellence of character to archery. And this is one way that maybe we can think about it today. So where we are looking for the sweet spot between, you know, negative options. So according to Aristotle, being virtuous was very hard. It was very much like trying to hit a bullseye on a target. It can be done, but you have to be practiced at it. And every virtue has a sweet spot. So for instance, it has a sweet spot and also has two vices. Either one that is a deficit or one that is going over the top, right? So for instance, when it came to courage, the deficit of courage is cowardice. And having too much courage would be rash, you know, not thinking things through, you know, being dangerous in some respects. Other examples here, apathy and zealotry are the two different vices that are part of concern. Order is what we would aim for in between chaos, which is a complete lack of order, and regimentation, which is far too much order. Freedom is what we hold dear. We've talked about this already, you know, as part of Western, American, maybe specifically, democracy. Freedom is a big part of that. Tyranny, complete lack of freedom. Anarchy, way too much freedom. No rules to govern society. Both are bad. Now, though these ideas are thousands of years old, virtue ethics was fairly recently resurrected in the West, in the mid-20th century, around the time of World War II. Most recent arguments for virtue center on emulating people whose characters we admire. We have a lot of this. We grew up with this, you know, people who are role models, right? A feminist approach, you know, something that is happening in society, you know, starting really in the late 1950s and the 1960s and into the 70s, is really being enunciated, was an approach that focused on caring and nurturing those virtues as being the most important to happiness. If you are a caring and nurturing person, you're going to bring about the best society. So there has also been a resurgence in interest in virtues in the world of engineering, in part because there is a huge lack of autonomy for a lot of engineers who are working, especially in corporate settings, where they're just one engineer in a vast group of engineers, and they may not be able to make their own decisions as well. Perhaps then, if you choose virtue over other types of ethics, you are, you have a little bit more freedom in that, and you're just choosing to be an honest person. You're choosing to be a fair person. You're choosing to be a loyal person. Maybe then you arrive at being ethical, especially if you don't have a lot of power elsewhere. For example, a lawyer who represents a drug dealer or another bad person or who might consider to be a bad person in society might not be helping the public good, as you would argue in utilitarianism. They might not having upholding some kind of duty to society, but it does comport to their code to represent their clients and the, you know, the loyalty that they have to their clients. The honesty that they have with comporting to their code, the fairness to everybody gets a fair trial. So that is being virtuous in that respect. Now, there are three strands of virtue ethics that are united in their a commitment to the following general principles. So number one, in order to live well, a person needs moral characteristics called virtues. Number two, a virtuous person is one who acts virtuously at all times. Number three, a person who acts virtuously if and when they possess and exercise a person will act virtuously if and when they possess and exercise virtues. And the fourth part of this would be an action is only right if it is an action that a virtuous person would carry out in a similar circumstance. So you can, again, focus on role models in some respects. Now, really, it does matter what type of person we are, right, in society. This is something that is a big part of how we are raised and what society emphasizes. Yet, really, utilitarianism or consequentialism, the larger category, and deontological or duty ethics, they have a tendency to ignore character. It's more about actions. But on the flip side, virtue ethics is pretty weak in some other areas. It's weak on telling us exactly what actions we should be taking to become virtuous, beyond looking for just virtuous role models, you know, whether it be Michael Jordan or Batman or, you know, not to be silly, but, you know, Edwin Hubble, an astronomer, or Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook, or I don't, you know, whatever the examples might be. Virtue ethics lacks the level of guidance we might need if we were facing a tough situation. So, for instance, when the choice is between the lesser of two different evils, you know, both options are pretty bad. Which one are you going to choose? Virtue ethics might, you know, get you to just to an impasse where you can't make a decision. Also, what virtues should be emphasized over others? You know, if you have like five virtues, four, you know, Plato had, Aristotle had his own, we all might come up with our own. What should we emphasize? Which are the ones that we are okay to ignore? What is being ignored? Are all virtues equal? You know, so if they're all equal, can you subtract a few and still be okay? You know, maybe this just boils down to our individual prejudices. Maybe it's societal or cultural preferences that exist at a particular time. And remember, societies, cultures change over time. So if you're thinking about the long term, that might be a problem. Ultimately, it's about whatever helps us sleep at night. You know, whatever puts our minds at ease. We operate out of our own personal ethics all the time. Do we cheat on exams? Hopefully not. Hopefully, you know, cheating on exams would not make you sleep well at night, and so we don't do it. Do we borrow or appropriate other people's ideas? Do we collaborate too closely with other people when we're working on projects, whatever it might be? Lines are certainly blurry a lot of the time. Virtue ethics, however, doesn't necessarily help you navigate the blurry stuff. So that's where it's a little bit weak. Now, a subset of virtue ethics that has become quite popular, really starting in the 1960s again, although it's based on a much older idea, is Stoicism. Especially popular in military circles or in institutions that are highly regimented. The motto of Stoicism is bear and forbear, right? So be able to put up with it and to be able to kind of forgive. This syncs up really nicely with the military traits of self-control, discipline, endurance, especially in crisis situations. Now, it was Greek in origin, originally, but it was really in ancient Rome that it was popularized, and popularized by the man here on the horse, the emperor Marcus Aurelius, among others. Basically, under this, under Stoicism, there's this understanding that we all seek happiness. Ultimately, that's what life is about. We're seeking happiness. We want to thrive. We want to do good things. We want to be good. The virtue is excellence of character at its core, basically. So this should be internalized according to Stoicism. And it depends very little on the things that are outside a person's control, which is maybe the vast majority of things in the world. So if you internalize being, you know, having excellence of character, then you can get past somehow or be able at least to deal with external pressures. So make the best of what power you have, no matter how small it is, and take the rest as it happens. That's one way to think about it. Popularized in the 20th century by individuals like Admiral James Stockdale. Admiral Stockdale was a Navy pilot during the Vietnam War, and he was shot down and taken prisoner. He was held in the notorious Hanoi Hilton in North Vietnam for 7 years as a POW. And 4 of those years he spent in solitary confinement. No other real access to other people. So basically, you know, just thrown away in a solitary cell. And during that process, he was repeatedly tortured in horrific ways. Eventually, he was freed after the war was over, he explained that he had been able to withstand a lot of the torture and these terrible conditions, the loneliness that went along with it, the not knowing about what was going on in the outside world, because he was reflecting back on his college days. And he had actually taken a class in college that had introduced him to the philosophy, the ancient philosophy of Stoicism. In fact, he had read a book written by Epictetus, who was a philosopher at the time. And Stockdale believed that upon being captured and tortured, he basically had been thrust back into the world of the Romans. He'd been thrown back in time, 2,000 years before modern events. And so he relied on these Stoic teachings of Epictetus that he remembered in a way so that he could make himself distant from his pain, but at the same time still be lucid, so it wouldn't just kind of check out of the situation. He tried to find a place where he could not be harmed by the actions of others, even though, of course, he was suffering physical and emotional pain. The only thing under Stoicism that he was basically responsible for was his own shame, his own sense of fear, or remorse, you know, regrets, whatever they might be. Those would all be internalized, and those are things that he could control, at least according to the Stoic principles. So under this, it is not your role to discern your part, but it is your role to play your part well. And Epictetus also said, it's not what happens to you, but how you react that matters. So these are important concepts within that. The Stoics really go deep into this, and they have a tendency to dismiss possessions, rewards, offices, honors, whatever they are, as things that delude us, that draw us away from what truly matters. And what truly matters, according to the Stoics, is moral character, integrity, and free will, or the self. Likewise, the Stoics see fear, concern, and anxieties as insubstantial pretenders to what is important. Properly understood, they are, if you know about them and you're set up to deal with them, they are insufficient impediments to fulfilling our moral duties and having a good life and being of good moral character. So for the Stoic, self-respect is a decisive moral quality. It's easy to make decisions underneath this, under its principles. It's a philosophy that belittles physical harm, since physical harm is nothing in comparison to what would be considered the devastating agony of shame, falling down on the job, falling down on your duty, right? So it has a great strength in that regard. It limits one's vulnerability to externals beyond your control, which is true of the regular world. It's also, you know, at the forefront of war and combat, much, you know, bigger events, the possibility of being injured or being tortured, captured, whatever they might be. So you are not vulnerable, or you limit your vulnerability underneath Stoicism. But that's one of its biggest weaknesses, too, is in limiting your ability to feel externals. You can limit your ability to care for others, including your family, including your friends, including colleagues, people you've never met before, but who have rights, right? And you may have a duty to them. You might be setting yourself up for a greater emotional break. This is what some philosophers actually think. So, because emotions are part of humans, and vulnerability is a part of what makes us people, and it almost sets us up, to be afraid of emotions. And it actually might be a big part of PTSD, you know, where you have submerged your emotions and your vulnerability to terrible war situations so much that you might actually be giving yourself what they call a mind wound, you know, something that will come to haunt you much later. Some argue that you should actually do the opposite, that vulnerability is extremely important in certain situations, even in combat, and that Stoics, in valuing obligation and duty above everything else, they're setting up the practitioners of Stoicism, soldiers in particular in this case, to become, you know, capable of carrying out the worst of war crimes, because they are just following orders, quote-unquote, and not putting themselves necessarily in the shoes of the other people because they're internalizing everything. So there's a writer named Jonathan Shea who talks about some of these ancient philosophies and how they apply to the Vietnam War. He wrote a book called Achilles in Vietnam. He argues that moral injuries from violating ethical beliefs may be harder to overcome than PTSD that comes from witnessing violence. So that's bad, but actually, you know, disconnecting yourself from vulnerability, from caring, from, you know, the things that Stoicism seeks to get past might actually be worse, and worse for society in general. The higher burden on Stoicism is for the military itself, and even the society protects soldiers' mental well-being, and to preserve and respect moral ideas as being more than just propaganda. So that's, you know, another way to look at it. So maybe it's just too closed off to emotions, and so there's big problems. All of these frameworks, no matter how tantalizing they might seem at first blush, are going to have drawbacks that need to be acknowledged. Now, a final... Yes, and we're coming to nearly the end here, although we're going to go through a... another hypothetical situation, but this is the final ethical framework that you are going to be responsible for knowing. It's another one that's not in the textbook. Pragmatism is also, by the way, a thoroughly American outlook. In fact, that it was invented in the United States in the 1870s. This emphasizes good consequences, so it's similar to utilitarianism, but it embraces a much wider range of values than simply just maximizing good by impartially considering the interests of everyone involved. It goes beyond that. It's really what it emphasizes is context. That's huge. So when you think pragmatism, you think context. In assessing facts, what we know to be true or what we think to be true, and the actions that we're going to take. So we're assessing the facts, and we have a certain amount of flexibility in weighing and balancing competing different values. Essentially, you're going to do the thing that makes the most sense without getting hung up on moral principles for a given time in a certain context. So we think of the atomic bomb here. We're going to go more into this, but this certainly was a pragmatic decision. Generally, a society is not going to build a super weapon that is capable of instantly incinerating hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people, with a single weapon in a very short amount of time. And generally the people that are being targeted by this are civilians, because you use nuclear weapons against cities for the most part. Generally a society is going to say, that's not a good idea. However, in the context of World War II, the United States will eventually make the... Now, a lot of the countries were working towards this goal, but the United States is the one that gets there first, and we decide to build a super weapon because the war is so horrible that part of the decision-making process, and part of the decision-making process of people like Albert Einstein and Leo Szilard, who we'll talk about more later on, was that if we can end the war, if we can shorten the war by creating something so horrible and destructive, then that is okay. Pragmatically, it's okay. So in that context of the time, it's fine. Another example would be, or a question maybe to ask, it would be, is it morally acceptable for you to cook over an unvented open fire in your apartment? Let's say you're living in IV, your stove isn't working, or you haven't paid your electric bill, and you really, really, really want to have flame-grilled hot dogs or steaks or whatnot. But you're also not really wanting to go outside and do it. So you just want to do it in your apartment. Is that ethically okay? Morally okay? Probably would say, no, that is unacceptable. It's too dangerous for you. It's too dangerous for the people who are living around you. However, now, context matters. Let's say you are cooking over an unvented open fire in your house right after a major earthquake in Haiti. You know, after the major earthquake there, or in New Orleans after Katrina has hit, and you don't have access to more safe conditions, or it's in Berlin or Hiroshima in 1945, as you know, the entire society around you is collapsing. Whatever, a time of crisis. So that is what, you know, part of the power of pragmatism is that you can set your moral principles that you normally would follow aside and follow a completely different path in a time of crisis. But let's talk about an ethical scenario here. We'll do an example of using pragmatic reasoning and how it might get you not where exactly you want to go. So let's say this is George. George is a recent graduate. He has a PhD in chemistry, so he's a chemist. Things should be looking good for him. He's out there looking for a job. However, the economy's not great, as it is, you know, for a lot of people who have just gotten their PhDs. And he's found it very hard to get a job. He also has some health problems, so he owes a lot of money when it comes to medical bills, so it limits his options also in terms of where he's going to be moving or where exactly he can work. His wife, throughout his PhD program, has been the main breadwinner in the family. She's had to support him and their family. They have, let's say, a bunch of kids. So there's been a lot of family strain over the last couple of years. And getting a job would do a lot to alleviate that strain. Let's say he has three kids, and maybe childcare is a problem. It's very expensive. I learned this the hard way when I first had a child, and I started paying over $1,000 a month. Actually, it's more than that, I believe, because young children are more expensive to take care of than older children, actually. And so that, you know, also, so there's a financial drain. And also this guy, maybe he owes a lot of money when it comes to student loans. So he's in a desperate situation. But he has a buddy, and his name is Frank. And Frank is an older chemist that maybe George has worked with before, maybe in like an internship kind of role. He knows George. He knows George is a smart guy. He knows also about his situation. He knows how bad it is. He has somehow managed to locate a job, a great job actually for George. It pays really well, and it's close by, and you know, so it kind of fits in all kinds of different ways. The problem is the job is in a chemical and biological weapons lab. And Frank also knows that George has a strong political belief against building weapons of mass destruction. Let's just say that these are WMDs. And George is excited about getting a job, but feels at least, crunching against his personally held values that he can't take a job like that. It is immoral. Frank doesn't like chemical or biological weapons either. Buddy argues, hey, buddy, it's hard out there for a new chemist to get a job. This is a great job. And if you don't take this job, somebody else is going to be doing the work. The weapons, the lab that's making them, the job itself, they're not going anywhere. I'm merely finding somebody who I think is perfect for the job, and I know that you're a moral person. You need the money. You need to get your life in order. So you might want to reconsider it. Oh, and by the way, there is somebody who is kind of in the running for this job, and it is a guy named Sam. If you don't take the job, it's very likely that Sam, a colleague of yours, will get this job, who also has basically nearly the same level of expertise. You're a little bit better than him, at least on paper. The problem with Sam is he is not in any way, shape, or form opposed to chemical or biological warfare. In fact, he's excited about it. He wants to develop more weapons like this. He's almost overzealous about it. He's intrigued by the prospect of what would happen. He actually maybe wants to experiment with it a little bit more. So he has no moral constraints on him at all. And so here we are arriving at George's dilemma. He has his own ethical feelings about chemical and biological warfare. Strongly held beliefs, not something he just created, but he's had it for a long time. He's going to weigh this against his family situation, against his concern over someone like Sam getting this job, over his wife's values of the family stability and whatnot, you know, economic situation, whatever it might be, all of those things. And this is, you know, an extreme example, but these are all probably the things that we do when we make a decision that's going to change our lives quite a bit. So under a pragmatic framework, George will probably take the job. Generally wouldn't do it if there was another job available and if they didn't have all these other pressures that have started to mount. But if he takes the job, he can rationalize that he might be able to save his family, certainly. Start saving his health, right? He's going to start, you know, getting better medical treatment. He will maybe, save his economic standing, right? Pay off his student loans and have a decent job. He may even, you know, taking it to the nth degree, save the world. Because if he's working on the inside of this bio war lab, he might be able to somehow diminish the use of these weapons, build in some kind of protections so that it's harder for them to use or it's easier to safeguard against them somehow. Of course, in that process, he has just trashed all of his ethical beliefs, you know, by putting them on the back shelf. So you could argue that it's either a pragmatic decision on one hand and the decision that needs to be made in a crisis, or it is a gross rationalization that ignores your ethical ideas for a more immediate gain, personal gain in this regard. And of course, those are the pitfalls. Some of the pitfalls of pragmatism. Getting bogged down in the facts and details of the context of the situation and ignoring the overarching, maybe even universal moral principles that you had, at least up until that point in time, been clinging to. The benefit of pragmatism is that it's really flexible in assessing complex and different emerging situations, crisis situations. But there is a danger there of moral relativism, of being, you know, just being able to make any decision at any time. And there, it seems like maybe there are no right answers, so any choice you make is fine, or that all answers are right. That's a problem. Very popular framework, especially in the United States, in modern U.S., modern Western culture, I would say, just like cost-benefit analysis, because it gets you to a decision. Sometimes you have to make decisions quickly. You know, you don't have time to ponder things out too long, but it has its downsides. Now, those are the main ethical frameworks. Let's talk about when a framework has, or you have kind of been inducted into a framework, or maybe you have adopted a framework that has been developed by an institution. And in this case, we're going to talk about corporate ethics, something that is also that we've talked about before, but will continue throughout the class, because most of you will work, if not in a corporate setting, in a corporate-like setting, in an institutional setting, something like that. So one of the big difficulties of being an engineer and trying to adopt ethical standpoints is that it generally happens in the context of a corporation where you have maybe very little power and you may be asked to make something, or perform in an uncomfortable way, given whatever ethical beliefs you brought to the table with you in taking this job, whether it's a chemical or biological weapons plant, or probably more likely a tech firm or a government agency or whatever it might be. So the problem is the very nature of the corporation. And at the bottom, what is paramount to a corporation, what is paramount good for a corporation, is money. Corporations are constructed in order to make money. That is their goal. It is illegal, actually, for a corporation, especially, you know, when you have shareholders, to set about to not make money, or to hold not making money not as kind of the basis of what the corporation is there for. Corporations are legally, socially, and historically constructed things, and they are given certain rights by the law and have been framed as legal persons. This is also kind of complicating this issue, because we've been in the last, decade or so, questions have come up over and over again. What are the rights of corporations? Mitt Romney, who ran for president very famously against President Obama in 2012, said, quote unquote, corporations are people, my friend, when he was, you know, talking to a voter. We've seen this play out when it comes to law. The Supreme Court in 2010, 2 years before that, decided something called the Citizens United case, which basically said that corporations are people and that corporations should be bound by the same rights that people have. And in this case, they should be allowed to spend unlimited amounts of money for one candidate or another in an election. And of course, we're going to see to a certain extent how that's playing out this year. So, corporations' behavior, its decision-making is shaped by the law, and by law, a publicly traded corporation must maximize profits above all goals. That is what it is. If it is a person, in a legal sense, legal construction, the goal of this person is to make money for their shareholders specifically. Not necessarily for the people who are buying their products, not necessarily for the people who are working there, but for the people who have a stake in the corporation, who put their money into the corporation in order to make the money. Lee Iacocca, the former head of Chrysler in the 1980s, and kind of considered maybe like a guru of people who are interested in business, wrote many books about this, but he once wrote, "Our customers are not the people buying our cars, but the people who are buying our stock. That's who we have a responsibility to." It has been used, of course, as a means, as an excuse for bad behavior. That also means that some decisions that corporations might otherwise make are essentially forbidden. They cannot choose to not make money. So one textbook asks whether or not a corporation can even be a moral agent. Do they even have ethics? Can a corporation, quote unquote, can a corporation be a moral agent like an individual? And the author goes on to say that, or ask, if a corporation has no moral agency, then it cannot be held accountable for its actions, although sometimes individuals in the corporations can be held accountable. So this suggests that corporations themselves cannot be ethically ethical inherently. They're not inherently ethical institutions. And so if you are attaching yourself to the corporation with the idea that the corporation is going to be making the right decisions, you may be setting yourself up for a problem. So corporations might not be held accountable because they are not ethically inherently ethical, but you as an employee might be held accountable. And so that's some of the danger there. So just simply saying I was simply following orders, as if you're in the military, which we've already talked about, was not an excuse that society deemed okay when it came to war crimes during World War II, society might also not accept that, you know, if you're saying, well, I was just doing what the company told me to do. So there can be ethical corporations, however. I mean, we've seen those things demonstrated. They are companies that treat their employees well, they make good products and profits, so at the same time, and they can give back to their communities. It's not all about taking the money and profiting, although profit's important, but you also, whatever largesse you might have, you redistribute to the community. So Hewlett-Packard, once upon a time, had a no-layoff policy, so even when the economy turned sour, you would not be laid off as an employee. Ben and Jerry's, the ice cream makers, they will give their employees time off to work for charities or volunteering of some kind. At the other end of the spectrum, of course, there have been very unethical companies. Enron, very famously in the early 2000s, basically promoted and rewarded unethical behavior. It was part of the company policy to manipulate energy markets. There are all these brownouts in California around that time that were artificial and supposedly based on, you know, lack of energy, but really was just making money for Enron. These things eventually came to light, and this enormous energy company collapsed. A lot of people who were honest people who worked for the corporation who didn't know about any of this chicanery that really was being managed by the officers at the top, they lost their jobs, they lost their life savings, they were humiliated in many respects. So And you can argue, okay, so Enron's one example, but VW, who we talked about before, Volkswagen, right? GM, maybe they're like this, you could argue. British Petroleum, possibly unethical like that. Facebook, Apple, whatever it might be. You know, companies that are obviously still around. Individuals who are in themselves their own kind of corporations, like Martin Shkreli. I think that's how you say it. He was kind of infamously the CEO of a pharmaceutical company who decided to jack up the price of a drug that used to cost $13 and that a small amount of people needed, but he jacked it up 5,556%, realizing that it was hard to manufacture drug to a certain extent, but also, you know, that you could maximize the profits for the corporation. So it goes from $13 to $750 per pill. He's also the guy who bought like a Wu-Tang Clan album for $2 million and just decided not to share it with anybody else. So he was in jail for a short period of time, and he's now under indictment for insider trading, so he's got his own issues. But I mean, he's kind of like a poster boy for corporate ethics, or the lack thereof. So as employees, it's kind of hard to determine how your company's corporate culture how it operates a lot of the time, but you can look at the things that are valued within the corporation and what is rewarded. Enron rewarded unethical behavior, so that might have given you kind of a concept in that that was an unethical corporation. There are four features of a corporation that could mean that it is an ethical corporation. Number one, in the world of the managers and the employees, that there is an acknowledgement, especially from the higher-ups, of the complexity of ethical values, that it's not cut and dried, that there are emergent situations, things that change. And so what they try to do, especially corporate officers, they try to balance the needs of the stockholders, which is important to them, of course, with a larger public good. Secondly, they speak in an ethical language. They may have a corporate code of ethics. Hopefully it's explicit. Explicitly stating the ethical responsibilities in job descriptions for management, especially. It can't just be lip service. It can't just be for show. They have to also, though, put their money where their mouth is when it comes to these codes. Enron had a code of conduct that they completely ignored, and especially the top execs didn't follow it at all, although the people generally below them did. There is a recent scandal with Wells Fargo doing this kind of thing too, where they have ethical codes for the people at the lower rungs, but the top execs got big cash payments even when they're engaged in fraud. So it's this kind of ongoing thing. Three, top management hopefully is going to set the tone by example or in words or in the policies that they choose for how the corporation runs in an ethical way. So, for instance, one of the heads of Hewlett-Packard in the 1970s, he was a head in the 1970s all the way back to the 1950s, but he consistently wore less than expensive clothes, drove a beat-up old car, didn't upgrade his furniture in his office from the original furniture that had been there from when the corporation opened, because he considered that to be a frivolous expenditure, not important to the bottom line of the corporation. And, doesn't signal that window dressing, cosmetic looks are as important as how the company operates. Ben & Jerry's, who I mentioned before, not only do they allow their employees time off to engage in charities, but they actually donate about 8% of their profits towards charities. This is in a world where the average for corporate donations to charities is about 0.8%. So Ben & Jerry's and Macy's both give about 8% of their profits to charity. Kroger's, a grocery store chain, is about 10%. Walmart, a little lower, is about 4.5%. Google is 9.3%. So maybe have some other issues with things that Google does, but in terms of charities and whatnot, the moral tone there, they may be setting a high precedence. Costco, 0%. It's negligible to charities. Amazon and Microsoft are also very, very low on the totem. Although Bill Gates is one of the largest philanthropists in that regard, so you could talk about it a little bit differently. But anyway, so top management setting moral tone. Finally, within the corporation, if an ethical dilemma comes up, there are very clear procedures for conflict resolution that are designed to protect the people who may be whistleblowing, who finding the problem. So they are confidential about moral and ethical troubleshooting situations, places that they can go to talk about these things. Internal discussions and internal handling of problems in order to mitigate whistleblowing. Whistleblowing is an extreme action, which we'll talk about later, something that most people don't want to do. Hopefully, corporation that you're working for, the institution that you're working for, is going to do its utmost to answer the problem without forcing you to go above people's heads or go outside of the institution to deal with the problem. So developing your own ethical framework is important to this class. It hopefully is important to your life, and it's something that you have to do yourself. It has to work for you personally. It's not just a regurgitation of utilitarianism or rights ethics or pragmatism, whatever it might be. It should be fairly clearly enunciated. It's there. You should develop it so that you're thinking through specific ethical dilemmas. This is what the group projects are really all about. You're in groups, as you are in the world of work, but each individual group member is working through their own ethical standpoints. They may agree, they may disagree. We'll talk more about that as we get close to those projects. So over the course of the next 10 weeks, you want to figure out your own ethical framework. I think this is the most important thing you probably can get out of this class. So it may adhere to one particular theory. It may blend a couple of theories together. You should be very specific about why you're choosing these theories and in what circumstances you're going to be using them. One of the things you want to do, you should have a set of questions you might ask of a particular situation by the end of the term. There will be an assignment that we attach to this. So in the world of science, and this is a big oversimplification, but the best theory is the one that fits the facts. It correctly predicts something that we are able to measure or observe. And we can have sort of the same process in ethics. Each of us has, or hopefully has, a deeply held set of beliefs. We may be against the extinction of endangered species. We may be against the military-industrial complex, or we have a pro-national security perspective, or against research using animals, or whatever it might be. You know, we hopefully have some ethical beliefs. You know, things that we will be willing to fight for. If a given ethical theory that we've chosen conflicts with any of these deeply held beliefs, the conclusion is that the theory made a false prediction and you can reject it. So you've chosen it, you crunched it through your beliefs, and you'll be able to reject it. So the best theories or frameworks are the ones that have what we call accuracy, power, and scope. Accuracy, when applied to a specific problem, the theory predicted the right result. The natural sciences, these are checked by empirical tests or experiments. In ethics, we're going to check it against deeply held moral beliefs, right? So that's the accuracy. When applied to a specific case, it's consistent with our deeply held beliefs. Those that do that are more and more accurate. A good theory will also challenge known facts and beliefs. Often our intuitive beliefs are inconsistent or in conflict with one another. So when a scientific theory successfully confronts and overthrows an accepted fact, we call this theory powerful. So that's power. The power comes into it. A powerful ethical theory helps us rethink our positions, question ourselves, question our deeply held beliefs. We can see this in politics. You may support or oppose abortion, but support or oppose the death penalty. You know, you may be on one other side of that. Or oppose welfare spending that might help a poor or single mother support her newborn. Those beliefs seem to be in conflict with each other. Ethical theories help you work through these conflicts. Ask a question. When does life begin? Does the state have the right to take a life? How do we balance individual rights against the public good and whatnot? Finally, we want a theory to have scope. A framework should be able to solve a very broad range of problems, from the mundane everyday to the highly unusual once-in-a-lifetime problems. an ethical theory that tackles problems of natural resources and land use and development and experimentation and research, has more scope than a framework that can only help with only one of these areas, right? So next time, we will be talking about the dealing with the unknown. You're going to watch a couple of movies that segue into, like I've talked about, nuclear power and the choice to build an experiment on nuclear weapons and whatnot. And so that'll be kind of the basis for what we'll be talking with for the unknown, but it also kind of leads you, you know, into dealing with a situation that you had no expectation that was going to happen, and how you actually get to that point. And we will do that lecture in person.